Another question. How do you balance your time between metta and vipassana meditation? Do you do one more than the other, or find it helpful to put more time into one or the other? I know sometimes they can go together, such as noting a thought or feeling that arises while doing metta, but usually focus on one or the other. Really, you can focus your mind only one thing at a time. If you shift your focus from various things, then it would be difficult for you to proceed with the practice. Focus mind on one thing. When thought arises, focus mind on the thought. When feeling arises, focus mind on the feelings. When you practice metta, you focus mind on metta. And as metta also is not permanent, when metta practice, thought of metta disappears, whatever arises after that, you focus your mind on it. Metta practice cannot remain continuously, consistently, all the time. It also has ups and downs because the mind is not very steady. Until mind becomes steady, even metta practice is not consistent. So when it disappears, you go to whatever arises in your mind and body. You say between metta and vipassana meditation. So when metta disappears, that disappearance of metta, you become aware of it and know that even the metta is impermanent. Noticing impermanence in anything is vipassana meditation. That's, remember very clearly, anytime you become aware of impermanence, appearing and disappearing of anything, you are practicing vipassana meditation. So if metta disappears, you become aware of the disappearance of metta. That awareness of disappearance of metta is mindfulness practice. I am troubled in mind by unwholesome behavior I committed while using intoxicants. A couple of years ago, I stopped using intoxicants and the behavior stopped, but I am scared by the bad karma I created. What should I do? I have tried to deepen my spiritual practice. Okay. You remember the simile I gave you the other day, the Lona Pala Sutta simile, salt and cup of water simile, remember? I want to remind you in answering this question. Suppose you have a lump of salt, maybe teaspoonful of salt, you put into a cup. That cup becomes salty. Why? Because there is little water. If you put the same teaspoonful of salt into a river, Mississippi River, Amazon River, and so forth, does it make any difference in the water taste in those rivers? Doesn't. Why? The volume of water in those rivers is so huge. Similarly, when you have committed unwholesome karma, then you understand, as you said here, it was, you felt it was wrong, and when the mind is distorted, when you drink, become alcoholic, become intoxicated, your mind gets distorted. With the distorted state of mind, you are not mindful. Under that condition, you have committed something wrong. And then now you realize it. Then, instead of regretting, repenting, being remorseful, you said to yourself, this is wrong, I have done it, I don't want to do it again. From that time onward, you practice meditation, you practice mindfulness meditation, concentration meditation, metta meditation, give dana, be patient, help others. So many, thousands of good things are there open for you to do in the society. You do those things. Keep doing good things, so-called good things. Dana, sila, adhittana, virya, panya, so many things. Saddha, virya, sati, samadhi, panya, so many things you can do, good things. Keep doing them again and again and again. Punyanche puriso kaira kairate nam puna puna thammi chandam kairat sukho punya sucho. When you do something wholesome, keep doing it again and again and again and again and again. If you have no time to do again and again the same thing, think about it. Even thinking about it is a wholesome thing. Then you are collecting so many good karmas, like the water in a big river. And then little teaspoon of unwholesome salt, unwholesome karma, just absorb into it. And you will even not have a time to bear its fruits. So that's what you have to do. And this is the wonderful advice Buddha has given us. Just don't repent. Just don't be remorseful. Do more and more good things. Then you will be able to overcome your unwholesome karma. And make wholesome karma your wholesome habit. Kusala sila. As Samana Mandika Sutta says. I have been practicing the first seven jhanas for about 2 years without any formal instructions from a teacher. What advice can you give to perfect and refine the jhanas? My goodness, if you have attained seven jhanas, what instruction do you need? You don't need any instructions. You have already attained seven jhanas. And you keep doing it and you will go to the eighth also. Eighth jhana. I don't have any advice to give you. If you have attained these jhanas, keep doing it, repeat it again and again, then you will perfect those jhanas. Another question, what is the difference in meditation between mind state and mind content, dhamma? Mind states are, as I mentioned, divided into eight pairs. Saragan chittan, saragan chittan te pajanati. Vitragan chittan, vitragan chittan te pajanati. One pair. Sadosan chittan, sadosan chittan te pajanati. Vitadosan chittan, vitadosan. Another pair. Samohan chittan, samohan chittan te pajanati. Vitamohan chittan, vitamohan chittan te pajanati. Another pair. Sankirtan chittan, sankirtan chittan te pajanati, vikirtan chittan, vikirtan chittan te pajanati. Another pair. Then mahagatanchitam, mahagatanchitam, tvajanati, amahagatanchitam, amahagatam, another pair. Samahitanchitam, samahitanchitam, tvajanati, asamahitanchitam, asamahitanchitam, another pair. Vimuttanchitam, vimuttanchitam, tvajanati, avimuttanchitam, avimuttanchitam. That means, when the mind is full of greed, become aware of the fact that the mind is a greedy mind. You can know greedy mind very easily. When mind becomes free from greed, then you become, this moment the mind is free from greed. Similarly, when mind is full of hatred, you become aware of the fact that it is hateful mind. When mind becomes free from hatred, you become aware of it. When mind is confused, you become aware of it. When mind is not confused, you become aware of it. Then, when the mind is withdrawn or depressed, become aware of it. When the mind is not depressed, you become aware of it. When the mind is not cultivated metta, amahaggata, then you know that mind has not cultivated metta. Mahaggata is the state when the mind is full of metta, then you know that mind is full of metta. When mind is concentrated, you know that it is concentrated. When it is not, you know that it is not concentrated. When the mind is free, liberated from greed, hatred and delusion, at least temporarily, or mind is free from hindrances, five hindrances, you become aware of it. When mind is not free from them, you become aware. This way, you just identify, recognize that very particular mental state you experience. That is mindfulness of the mind. Mindfulness of Dhamma is little more involved. That is, say for instance, hindrances. When particular hindrances arise, like greed, you know the mind is ordinarily does not have hindrance. It is just an average mind. Then, when hindrances, it is said, anuppannangva kamachandang anuppadava kamachandang uppadhoti pajanati. Uppannati pajanati. Greed was not in my mind, now greed arose in my mind. When greed fades away, you know that greed faded away, now there is no greed. When unnerishing greed arises or passes away, you recognize that. And erisent greed does not arise and completely vanish from the mind, you become aware. There are five such stages for each hindrance. There are five hindrances. Similarly, when you focus your mind on five aggregate, you recognize this is form aggregate. This form aggregate is made up of elements, and this form aggregate is impermanent, unsatisfactory, and selfless, and so forth. You get involved in the five aggregates, each of them like this. Then when eyes, senses, sensory objects come together, there arise a fetter. There are 10 fetters. When senses and sensory objects come together, consciousness arise, feeling arise, and consciousness arise, contact arise, feeling arise, perception arise, then a fetter arises. You see all this happening in the mental state. So this is called mindfulness of Dhamma. Or you see factors of enlightenment, each and every one of them arising and developing. Then you see the Four Noble Truths and so forth. Seeing them in a more wider sense, in more details, is mindfulness of Dhamma. This is the difference between mindfulness of the mind and mindfulness of Dhamma. Mindfulness of mind, you just become aware of one particular mental state and sit rise. Mindfulness of Dhamma, you get more involved in the mental factors. Next question. When sitting in the meditation hall, what am I supposed to be doing to be formally practicing metta? Right now, I begin by reading the metta discourse, and once done, I am mindful of following my breath or my body breathing. Should I be repeating, may all beings be happy and secure, may all beings have happy mind, silently to myself, and cultivate a feeling of sincerity with doing this? When you want to practice metta, only metta meditation, you just keep thinking, developing metta thought, and feel metta in your heart, and keep repeating it in thought and feeling. You may pass the verbal stage very quickly. Verbalizing all the time is not necessary. We verbalize for a short period of time and then think about metta. Think, there are so many benefits of metta. Friendly feelings in a very deep sense. And think of not having hatred, anger in you towards any living being. And then you begin to feel in your heart friendly feelings. That's what you do in pure metta practice. However, if you lose that practice, then you will see your breath, feeling, perceptions, thought, and so on, and see them rising and falling, appearing, disappearing, and start practicing mindfulness meditation. Another question. Everything is temporary. What is the point of your whole life? How do you find meaning in it? You see, a friend who wrote this question, everything is temporary, very sure. What is the point of your whole life? Knowing, understanding this temporariness of everything. Why? Friends, because of not seeing this reality in our lives, we are always in pain and suffering. Once we really fully comprehend, understood, and perfect our understanding of this very reality of impermanence, then we will not have any more suffering. And Buddha said, not because of not understanding, because of not understanding the reality, we suffer. So the purpose of our lives really is understanding the reality, which is the truth, Dhamma, established Dhamma. Whether the Buddhas come into existence or not, this established Dhamma exists forever. Aticca Samuppada, dependent origination, exist whether the Buddhas come into existence or not. That means, due to causes and conditions, things arise. When this arises, almost simultaneously with that, next thing arises. When this arises, that arises. When this passes away, that passes away. This also is established Dhamma, true Dhamma. Impermanence is established Dhamma, true Dhamma. So, in our life, every single moment, if we spend trying to understand this reality, you can see so many things are happening in the whole of our experience, and they all are appearing, disappearing, appearing, disappearing, so on. And therefore, when we understand this reality, our mind will not be foolish to hold on to anything, because we cannot hold on to anything. Friends, this is 1000 true Dhamma. 1000% true Dhamma. 1000, not 100%. Because you cannot refute it, you cannot deny it, you cannot fight it, it is there. And therefore, this is a very lofty thing. Not becoming attached to anything is a very difficult thing, very lofty thing. But if this even these lofty things, we begin to gain some understanding of it, so we can move along with this life without too much pain and suffering. Suffering arises. Suffering is there purely because, not because of impermanence, but because of our attachment to impermanent things, because of our attempt to become attached to impermanent things. We cannot attach to impermanency, cannot. But we make effort to become attached to impermanent things. And that always causes pain and suffering. So, your question is very pertinent, relevant question. That is the purpose of our life. Trying to understand the reality, the truth, and it will not happen overnight, you know, very quickly, but we can get there slowly and gradually if we keep our minds open to see this reality without any prejudice. We just keep our mind open. Impermanence does not belong to Buddhism. Impermanence doesn't belong to anybody. Whether you are Buddhist, Christian, Hindu, Muslim, Jew, Zoroastrian, whatever, you are subject to it, subject to impermanence. So, another question. At mealtime, one of the reflections state, all this alms food is pleasant as it is, but when it is used by this body, it becomes extremely unpleasant. Is it not true? Is there anything to explain? Alms food, when it is in the pot, on the plate, is very pleasant. Lot of aroma, watering your mouth, increasing your appetite. It doesn't stop there. When we consume it, we don't have to do anything, just put into a mouth and then throw it into a plate. Would you like to eat it back? Huh? let alone metabolizing and coming out, but just put into mouth and put it back into the plate, you don't want to eat. Suppose you have a little stone or pebble or little insect in your food, and you put it in the mouth, and then you realize, there was an insect. Then you may even throw away the whole plate, let alone throwing away everything you put into the mouth. So, when anything is metabolized, digested, pure, clean water used up by the body to do the function of water, when it comes out, not very pleasant. So we reflect on this reality, that's not something artificial, it's very natural, real. And therefore, the reason is that we should not be greedy, gluttonous, attached to our food. It is used just to maintain this body. Another question. Suppose a farmer knows he cannot avoid killing insects while ploughing, watering, digging, etc. Likewise, an Eskimo hunts to survive because the Arctic is not good for growing vegetables. It seems that both take life not out of hatred but out of necessity. How to understand this in terms of the teachings of non-harm and non-killing? Now, unfortunately, Eskimos, if they kill to survive, and we don't say that is a good karma. Eskimos, it is very unfortunate that they were born in that region as Eskimos. There are eight difficult situations to be avoided by us. They are called attakkana, eight situations. That is thayo apaya arupa sanyang pachyanti mapiche. Then michaditya daruna pachyananca vekalya. Let me tell them in English. To be born in four woeful states: animal, ghost, in hellish condition, and goblins. Four stages. And to be born in areas where Dhamma cannot be practiced. To be born at a time when Buddha's Dhamma is not practiced. And to be born with lot of physical deformation. And to be born even in a state called Asanyasatta, the state where beings don't have perception, sanyi, asanyi, asanyatala. To be born in these areas are very unfortunate, because those are the areas, those are the situations where we cannot avoid pain and committing unwholesome karmas. Unfortunately, to be born as a human being in the area where there is no any other way to live but killing Although they are human beings, unfortunately they have no way to avoid killing. And therefore, we have to admit that killing is killing, whether you are in Eskimo or in any other place. So, that is hunting. Now, your question is farmers. They are born in good human conditions, healthy conditions, and they have to do farming. But when they farm the land, they don't go out and say, let me kill 10 insects today, or 50 insects tomorrow, 100 snakes today, and so forth. They are not going out with this intention. Not with the intention of killing, they do farming. They do farming with the intention of farming the land. Unintentionally, animals get killed. They are not responsible for that. So, out of necessity, how to understand these terms, this in terms of teaching of non-harm and non-killing? Well, for harming or killing, there are five conditions. If someone does not fulfill these five conditions, that individual does not commit unwholesome karma, or commit the karma of killing. What are the five conditions? In case of an animal, one should know that this is an animal. Second, one is that the being must be a living being, that is condition one. Second is the awareness or knowledge that it is a living being. The third is the intention to kill. Fourth is a way, a method, system to kill. Fifth is fulfilling these four conditions, the person put the intention into action. By having intention, killing is not complete. By using a method and does not kill, that's not complete. And if accidentally, in case of farmer, while clearing the land, he take a big rock and throw, and the rock land on a little rabbit, rabbit will be crushed and killed. He is not responsible for killing. And so forth, all the five conditions must be fulfilled in order to complete the killing. And some farmers are not actually responsible for killing because they don't have any intention of killing. However, if anybody intentionally kills, whether it is farmer or anybody, that is a killing. Last question, also big question, long question. I work with the untouchables in this country, brain trauma, autism, then cerebral palsy, blind, mute, wheelchair bound, etc. Why do you want to call them untouchables? Anyway, these are the list. This is the list of individuals you are working with. We work with music and the art. We experience transformation in these people that have been forgotten. Their souls are refreshed. Their hearts are renewed. Why is music not used here? These folks have been labeled and shut out how they are renewed. Now, using music as a therapy to help these people is one thing, and what we are doing is quite another. We are not dealing with this kind of people because they need a specially trained people to take care of them. And this is one of the methods you use to take care of them. This is acceptable, even recognized. They are beneficial, and we have no objection to that. Even in Buddhist tradition, we use chanting and so on for cure some diseases, sickness. And what we are doing is a wonderful thing, very good thing. We always appreciate this kind of help to see them, you know, having uplifted feeling and getting calm, peaceful and so forth. They are wonderful thing. Your question is, why is music not used here? Because we are doing something different, not what we are doing over there. And therefore music here would be a disturbance. And when you use music for so-called normal people, their mind will be on the music and will not make any improvement in their wisdom. That is good to calm the person, make the person relatively comfortable. But that's not all. We want to do something more than that. And these people you mentioned cannot do what we are doing here. For them, what you do is very good, very important. But what good for them may not be good for our situation here. That is why we are not doing it here. With this, I want to end tonight's answering questions. And I must thank you all for writing very clearly. I can read them without too much struggle. Thank you, and have a good night, and continue your practice.
Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.